All right, good morning, everyone. Good morning to students online. Welcome to our session this morning. Let's pray, and then we will get into our teaching. Let's pray. Father, we thank you once again for this beautiful day. We could come together and learn and study your word. Lord, we thank you for the covenant that you have brought us into, O God. And even as we study and learn, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will minister into our hearts, that we will understand that every word that we study, God, will be a seed rooted deep in our hearts that will bear fruit in our lives. We thank you, Lord. We just surrender this next 2 hours of studies into your hands, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Okay, so firstly, I would like to apologize because I was just talking to the students here, and I had been using the old notes that I had, right? So it's completely. So I realized that in the new notes, we had to. There are quite a few updated topics, updated chapters. So if you have your old notes with you, sorry, the new notes with you, we'll get into chapter 10. Right. Before, I know that last class I said we completed on the cross, but there are a few more aspects of, sorry, the covenants. There are a few more aspects of the covenants that we'll cover. So if you have your notes open, get into chapter 10, which is High Priest and Mediator. Now we talked a little bit about it, but let's go a little in detail, and then we'll try to complete 10, 11, and 12 today. And if we have time, we'll get into section 2, which is the cross, right? Okay, sorry for that bit of confusion there. Okay, chapter 10, the high priest and mediator. Now, all of us, we know about what the high priest is, right? Everyone know in the old covenant what the work of a high priest was. He was to stand as a mediator between the people of Israel and God. Who was the first high priest? Who?
Melchizedek.
Okay. So all of us know what is the role of a high priest, right? Now we're going to look at what the resurrection and the exaltation of Jesus means for you and I as believers. Chapter 10, page 40 on your notes. Okay, Jesus Christ was the firstborn from the dead, Colossians 1:18. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have preeminence. Now, as a mediator, right, Jesus is the firstborn from the dead, meaning what, right? As the head of the church, right, the firstborn from the dead, meaning. Now, the Lord Jesus was born as a human being. Did only his spirit die, or did his body also die? Why are you so confused? Okay. His body also died, right? And so right now, you and I, we have a physical body. And we will also face death. A time will come when we will face death. But he is the firstborn from the dead. So it's like saying, he overcame death, because he lives, we will live, right? He is our mediator. He is our high priest. 2, he has authority over hell and death. Revelations 1:18. I just want to ask, some of you to just open your verses, open these verses, keep them ready so that we can just read them immediately. Right? Revelations 1:18, Jesus, as a high priest, has authority over hell and death. Go ahead, read, please.
I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death.
This verse should give us goosebumps. We must feel something in our spirit. Behold, Jesus is saying, the resurrected Jesus, right? He's saying, I was alive, I was dead. Jesus himself is testifying, saying, I was dead, but now I'm alive. And I hold the keys of death and hell. So who is in control over sickness and death and hell? Who's in control? Jesus. It looks like the enemy is in control, but Jesus is in control. It's very, he has the authority over hell and death. If he wants something, nobody can stop it. And I was reading this testimony, and about this testimony, it's happened quite some time back in the early 2000s. This man was a pastor. He became old, and he had a heart attack. After he had a heart attack, he survived that heart attack. And after, you know, he survived, he came out of the hospital. He made a tape, right, of all the healing verses in the Bible. Right, he made a tape. He recorded his own voice, all the healing verses. Right? And he told his wife, if I have another heart attack, what you do is you take the CD player during the early, I think it was early 1990s or 2000s. He said, take the CD player, put the headphones on and leave it. Don't listen to the doctor. Let the doctor say anything, you put it on. So it happened. Many years later, he had a massive heart attack. They brought him to the hospital. They, you know, put the ECG and all of that. There was a flat line. That means brought in dead. So his wife, instead of crying, got the headphones and put it on him. And the Bible verses are going on. So all the nurses are saying, no, you can't do all this. I said, no, anyway, he's dead. This is not going to, why are you worried? Put the thing. The next day there was a pulse. He not only recovered, but in 2 or 3 days, he went back home, brought in dead. Who has the authority of hell and death? Satan bought death. Satan, through a heart attack, bought death. But who has the authority? If Jesus decides he has to live, he has to live. That's done. It's finished. Nobody can change that. Right? So as a mediator, God is in control. It's very hard, no? Especially for us, and something happens to our own family members. It's very hard. You say, God, why is, why? No, we're all believers. Why is it happening to us? Right? We pray, we read the word, we do everything. Why is it happening to us? Why all the others there, you know, nothing is happening. Why is it happening to us? Remember, God has the authority over hell and death. He knows what he's doing. We got to trust him, right? All authority belongs to Jesus as a high priest, as a mediator. All authority belongs to him. Let's read, maybe one of you read Hebrew, Matthew 28:18, and then we can also read Ephesians 1:20 and 23, 20 to 23.
And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.
Yes. Ephesians 1, 20 and 23. Go ahead.
Which he worked in Christ when he raised from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power, and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in the age, but also in that which is to come.
Amen. Look at this. Matthew 28, Jesus has finished the work. He has resurrected. He is going to heaven, and he's saying all authority has been given to the Father. From the Father, the Father has given me all the authority. Right. And Ephesians 1:20, right? All, he has seated him in the highest places, over all principalities, over every power of the enemy. You know, when Jesus was on the cross, he said this word. What did he say? The Greek word is tetelestai. That means it is finished. It is finished. Basically, what Jesus did was he crushed the devil's head. He destroyed the devil. He destroyed, completely destroyed. So all authority belongs to Jesus. And the question may come, what about all the sickness that we see? What about the persecutions? What about the earthquakes and the famines and all of this that's happening? All of that will happen, but they will not happen without God's permission. If Jesus says stop, it will stop. If Jesus says live, you will live. If Jesus says, okay, it's time, it's time. Nobody can stop him. All authority belongs to him. Do you understand that? Right? And you got to accept this as a mediator. And the best part is, Jesus says, I've come to give you life. He's not keeping us in suspense. Will we live tomorrow? Will we live next week? No. I've come to give you life. That is living in fear. That's not what God has called us for. Right? Every believer lives in the hope of the resurrection. There is a real heaven and a real hell. And the real eternity is something that each one of us must face. Look at this. Jesus set the perfect example for us. Why is he a mediator? Why can't a man be a mediator? Man cannot be a mediator because he cannot take up the sins of the world upon him. And so, if somebody has to be a mediator, and God cannot come and take away or take all the sins on himself. Like, he can't just say your sins are washed away. Even in the Old Testament, they took that lamb, right? The high priest will pray all the sins of Israel on this scapegoat. They call it the scapegoat. All the sins of Israel, all the millions of people, the sins are put on this goat. They will push that goat off from the cliff. And to make sure it dies, sometimes they would take stones and throw on that. And the moment that is dead, the scapegoat dies, they know that God has forgiven our sins. Our sins, the goat has taken all our sins. That's in the old covenant. That's why Paul writes and he says, there is one mediator between God and man, the man, Jesus Christ. Right now, Jesus is both God and he is man. And so he's the only one who's able to identify with us. You get what I'm saying? Jesus knows what it feels to fast and pray. He knows how it feels to fast and pray. Now we are fasting and praying 15 days over. Hungry, Lord, what to do? Jesus knows, hey, I fasted 40 days. I know what you feel. God the Father didn't fast. So you understand what I'm trying to bring out here. God the Father is not tempted. Jesus was tempted. You and I are tempted. We say, oh, Jesus, temptation is coming. Jesus will say, I went through it. I know how you feel. He's a mediator. He went through everything that you and I are going through. He was God. Now he's God and he's man. Will we doubt if Jesus comes and stands here? Will not doubt. He can come and stand. Why? Because he's man also. It's going to happen in the book of Revelations. You learn in eschatology. When he comes, 1,000 years he'll be on the earth. He's not coming as a spirit. He'll be a man. If you are alive in the millennium period, you can go shake hands with him. Because he's both God and man. Now you can't say, Jesus, come, I want to shake hands with you. He's in his glory. And John in the book of Revelation saw Jesus and said, oh God, his hair were like burnished cross, his eyes were like blazing fire. Out of his mouth came the double-edged sword. John, the disciple who's always with Jesus. Remember John? He's putting his head on Jesus' shoulder every time. That John fell at Jesus' feet as if he was dead. Now imagine, we can't go and say, hi Jesus, how are you? He's in his glory. Right? So every believer has the right to use the name above every name. Just because Jesus lives, we will live. Just because you and I are believers, we use the name of Jesus. We have the right. We have been given the authority. Jesus said, in my name you will cast out demons, you will cleanse the lepers, you will heal the sick. Greater things than I did, you will do in my name. So Jesus himself is saying, It's not like Jesus has gone to heaven and saying, who's using my name? No. He's saying, use my name. In my name, the demons will listen. Demons will listen. Sickness will listen. Diseases will go in the name of Jesus. Now, in the Old Testament, there was no in Jesus' name. You see what we have? Jesus himself didn't, you know, during the time of Jesus' ministry, he just said, be gone. Right? Calms the storm. He said, peace, be still. That's it. So when he did all that, he set the example. And then when you see the disciples, they started using in Jesus' name. Remember John, I think it's John 7, where Peter and John go to pray. What happens? Sorry, not John, Acts. In the book of Acts, Peter and John go to pray in the temple. There's a lame man sitting there saying, give me money. What does Peter and John say? Hey, look at me. That person is looking, maybe he'll get some money. He says, silver and gold I don't have. I don't have anything to give to you right now. But in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. What happened? 30 days before, what they were doing? 1 month before, where were they? Hiding? Okay, not 1 month. Maybe keep it 2 months. Right? 2 months before, well, what were they doing? Nothing. They were running around behind Jesus. Oh, looking at all of this. But the same disciples in Jesus' name are doing such great miracles. You and I have the authority. It's a commission given to us as a church. You use it. Right? Now, Jesus is not going to come and say, use my name, use my name. Say, I've done the work. The work is done. It's like this. Say, for example, we have to, you know, paint the build this inside house. Right? The painters have come, they've painted the entire, you know, the classroom here. But we're all standing out. Why? The painting is not done. And the painter saying it's done. Go and see. No, it's not done. But the painter saying, I did the work. I know I spent, what, 3 or 1 week here painting. I did the paint with my own hands. You're saying it's not done. Say, no, it's not done. Who's foolish? The painter or we? All we need to do is go and see it. Go and do what you have to do with it. It's like that. Jesus has done the work. And if we keep saying, no, I don't know what to do. I don't know why this is happening. Right? The work is already done. Jesus has commissioned us. Every believer has his resurrection power at work inside them. Ephesians 1, 19 to 20. Let's read.
And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places?
Yes. So, just read that portion again, once again, the first part.
And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power?
According to the working of his mighty power. Every believer, the day, you know, when Jesus died, the Holy Spirit came as a person, as his flesh was dead, his spirit. The Holy Spirit came and quickened his body. And brought life to his body. That is the resurrection power of the Lord of God, right? That same resurrection power, God is ready to exert that same resurrection power in each of our lives. It is the same Holy Spirit that resurrected Jesus. That is the same Holy Spirit working in each of us. It is not a mini Holy Spirit. It's the same Holy Spirit. It's not that there are plenty of Holy Spirits. Okay, for Jesus, it's level A. For pastors, it's level B. For believers, level C. No, it's the same Holy Spirit. It doesn't change. So think of this, picture it. Jesus is there. He's in the tomb. The same Holy Spirit that came and quickened Jesus's body. And then he stood up from the grave. He walked out of the grave. That same Holy Spirit is inside you and me. Now what should it do to us? The resurrection power begins to work in our life. Right? Look at his twofold role before the Father on our behalf. What is Jesus doing in heaven? Twofold role. We talked about it briefly last class, but let's look at it. Right? As a high priest, he stands on our behalf before the Father. Remember that? He holds his blood. Picture it. Right? This is the Father standing here. He's holding his blood. He's standing on our behalf. See, God sees sin. God the Father, when he sees sin, he has to punish that sin. Yes? You can picture Jesus standing there. No, Father, don't do that. Give him some more time. Give him some time. Let him. He will change. Right? Right now, he's going through a difficult time. He's going through pain. He's going through challenges. Give him some time. What is he doing? He's making intercession with the Father. And the Father will say, I'm seeing him because of the blood that you shed. So I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to take a step back. The Son will come in between because of the blood. Okay, that's number one. His role as an intercessor, an advocate, we'll talk about it later, especially in the cross, right? We'll talk about as a mediator, he stands before the Father and he enforces the new covenant for us here on earth. Number one, he's standing as a mediator before the Father, as an intercessor, and as an advocate. See, you know what's an advocate? He's standing before, he's saying, God the Father is taking this guy, I'm telling him for the past 5 years, change your lifestyle. Now I have to bring judgment. Because God is holy. He cannot look at sin and say, okay, it's okay, let it go. He cannot do that. That is why the entire wrath of God, the anger of God, was put on Jesus. So now Jesus is standing, hey, Father, I took it up on the cross. Advocate. But the Father takes a step back. He says, okay, all dominion, all authority is given to you, Jesus. You're my son. You have done the work. You can take it forward. And Jesus enforces the new covenant. He says, come on. He sends the Holy Spirit. And he begins to work. You understand? You understand what the role of Jesus is? Jesus is our high priest. Melchizedek in Genesis 14:18, he offered bread and wine to Abraham, right? And Melchizedek blessed Abraham. Melchizedek received the tithes of Abraham. Abraham, in the presence of Melchizedek, rejected the offer of the king of Sodom and stayed true to his faith. Jesus is our high priest. Jesus is our high priest. We offer to him all our sacrifices. And he is pleased with our sacrifice. Right, let's look at a few things here. The role in the Old Testament. The role of the priests in the Old Testament. The priests were anointed. They were consecrated. I know that we may know this, but let's just quickly look at a few points. Right? They were anointed and consecrated to minister to the Lord on behalf of the people of Israel. They offered sacrifices brought by the people to in the altar. If the anointed priest himself sinned, he had to make a sin offering for himself, right? So if the priest himself sinned, he should go make an offering for himself, saying, God, I have sinned, right? The priest would, as part of his robe, had the names of the 12 tribes on his breastplate of judgment over his heart when he went before the Lord. Okay, and he had the Urim and the Thurim on his breastplate of judgment. So this is a dress code that God gave the people, the high priest, right? He had the 12 tribes, 12 stones, the 12 tribes of Israel, right? And once a year, on an annual day of atonement, he went into the Holy of Holies to make atonement for the entire people once a year. I think the night before he wouldn't have slept. This high priest would have thought, oh, tomorrow I have to go for the entire people of Israel. I have to enter the Holy of Holies. Whole night he'll be sitting and thinking about it. He wouldn't have been sleeping in peace. How many of you, your results are the next day? 10 standard results, and you slept in peace. If you slept in peace, you're confident. You're completely not confident of clearing. It's one of those two. There's some kind of nervousness, right? And then every day we normally get up at 9 o'clock. This day you woke up at 6 o'clock. You're fresh. Why? So you know you're expecting something. Man, results. Same way. This high priest also next day. When will this day get over? Because I have to enter the most holy place where the glory of God will be there. And if I don't confess my sins, I will fall down dead there. And not only my sins, the people of Israel, everyone stopped their work. Everyone, you know, if it was live streamed, if there were videos and cameras, everyone would have seen that high priest stopped all the work. Stop the work. High priest is going inside. If the offering is accepted, he will come out. If it's not, he will not come out. The Day of Atonement. One day in the day of for the Israelites. The priests received the tithes that people brought. The priests had to be holy unto the Lord. And the priests blessed the people with the blessings of the Lord. Remember the blessings, right? He said, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you. Those were the priestly blessings. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May he be gracious unto you and grant you his peace, his shalom. That's the priestly blessings. That's what he will bless the people with. What did Jesus complete as a high priest? What did Jesus do? As a high priest, he was called by God. And he went to this place where of this heavenly priesthood, where he is the high priest, and he will always be. Here in the old covenant, they had to choose high priests. Eventually the high priest will die. Choose a new one, right? But here it's an eternal high priest. Jesus, he made propitiation. That means he paid the price for our sins. This time it is not the blood that the high priest will take and pour and run outside. No, not the blood of goats and rams. He took the price, right? Now, as a high priest, Jesus entered the heavenly tabernacle, offered his own blood once for all. Everyone say that, once for all. Once for all, finished, it's done. It's not like every year Jesus is in heaven. Where's the blood? Okay, come. Pour it again. Where's the blood? Pour it again every year. No. Once for all. He went to the Father. He said, God, I have done the work. I've paid the price. If you read in the book of Matthew, in the Garden of Gethsemane, I was just reading it this morning. The Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus is so troubled in his spirit. He says to his disciples, you pray, I'll go and pray, you also pray. He comes back. We don't know how long he prayed for, but he comes back. He sees they're fast asleep, the disciples. Then he wakes them up. We couldn't pray. And then, the Bible says he was so troubled in his spirit. Maybe the disciples have never seen him that way. He's never troubled. Why is he so worried? You think they would have thought that? Why is he so worried? We have never seen Jesus like this. Every time we see Jesus, he's standing there, walking on water, calming the storms, telling the devils to get out. Why is he so troubled? And he goes back, he prays, and he comes back again. Still they are sleeping. And you read that passage, it's so emotional, because Jesus says, Lord, if it's possible, take this cup away from me. I don't want to do this. I cannot do this. But not my will, that your will be done. I cannot do this. Why? Because from the beginning of time, I was with you. I'm sitting with you. From the beginning of time, I'm sitting with you. Now, you're asking me to take the sins of the whole world. I will become a sinner. I've not tasted sin, but I will become a sinner. And more than that, we will be separated. I cannot take that separation, God. Can you think of that? Jesus is saying, I cannot take this separation. So if this cup can go away, if there's any other way, try another way. But not my will, your will be done. And then the third time he comes back, he says to the disciples, that's powerful. Get up, the time has come. That means God has spoken to him and saying, my son, you have to do this. You have to do this because that's what I've sent you for. That's why the book of Hebrews says he was obedient to death, even death in a cross. The separation was too much for him. All through Jesus' earthly ministry, what was written? My Father is with me. I am in the Father is in me. My Father loves you, our Father who art in heaven. Everywhere, Father. On the cross, what does he say? What does he say?
Father, why have you forsaken me?
My God, why have you forsaken me? He doesn't say Father. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? That separation of sin. And then the grace of God comes in and he says, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. My God, that moment of the sins of the world was more painful than the cross, the nails and all of that. That is just a physical pain. Jesus died of a cardiac arrest. His heart stopped pumping and he died. But the emotional, what happened inside of him, that separation from God was too much for him. God said, yes, that's why Jesus said in confidence, I've done it. I've finished the work. That's what Jesus did for us. He completed the work as our high priest. Jesus is our advocate. 1 John 2, 1 through 2. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins. Not only for us, but also for the whole world. He himself is a propitiation. He himself, not a goat, not a ram, not a bull, not a calf. He himself paid the price. He's our advocate. The word advocate in Greek means parakletos, meaning called to one side or called to one's aid. When you look at a court, right? Now, somebody may falsely accuse you of something. Example, we have come to the court and then we have an advocate. An advocate will stand. You don't have to talk anything unless you're asked to talk. Unless you're, you know, if you've seen a courtroom, you talk only when you've been asked to talk or you've asked questions. Otherwise, you don't talk. Everything the advocate will say. See, this is what happened. 2005, he took this thing. And so now this is what the case is all about. Everything he will say. You have to just sit and listen. And when he asks you the question, you have to answer. That's all. Jesus is our advocate. He's our helper. How many of us feel weak and tired? Feel weary, feel pain. We all will feel that, no? He's our advocate. He's our helper. Jesus is standing next to us and he's saying, come on, I know it's difficult. I'm with you. I'm with you. You stand. And sometimes, you know, we just have to stand still and let God work. In Exodus, God brought the people of Israel out of Egypt, brought them near the river to the Nile, to the Red Sea. They come to the Red Sea. They said, Moses, there were no graves in Egypt, but you brought us here. Well, then what happened? People said, we'll go back. Now you can't go back. Pharaoh's army is going to kill you. You cannot go back now. You can't go front. You got the Red Sea. They said, let's stone Moses. What does God tell Moses? Tell the people to stand back. Stand still and see God working. That's what it says. Right? You just stand still. Don't do anything. I'll do the work. I will fight your battle. I told Moses, use the staff. Stretch it out to the waters. The waters parted into two. And the best part of that verse is the people of Israel crossed on dry land. Everyone say dry land. Now when it rains, how is the place? You know, there are people who have come up now and they're saying there was an east wind that came and another wind from this side, and that's why the whole sea was separated. Okay. It is separated because of the wind. How is the land dry? Give an explanation for that. There's no explanation for that. There's a reason it's written there. Only God can do it. Scientists will say, all these people who do geography and studies of these winds and all, actually there was a wind here that came, and then the seas were parted. It's happened before. That's why that is all a story. Okay. Well, that is fine. But dry land. Explain that to me. Can't be dry land. They walked on dry land. Their feet were not wet at all. Jesus is our advocate. He's our helper. He pleads our cause. He stands with us. Right? And the Bible, all across in the Bible, right, we have the Holy Spirit as our advocate. Right? In the New Testament, we have Jesus. We have Holy Spirit as our advocate. Look at this. We'll skip the part of courts in heaven, but we'll go to how the Parakletos. Right? When we say Parakletos means, what is Parakletos? Advocate, our helper, right? Our assist, right? How the Parakletos, Jesus, help us? He sent us the Holy Spirit, page 45. Jesus, our helper in heaven, has sent the Holy Spirit to be with us, which is the allos parakletos. Right? It's not like the Holy Spirit is, first is Father, first prize, second prize Jesus, third prize Holy Spirit. Right? We know this, right? All three are one. One God, three in essence. So in many places in the New Testament says the Spirit of Jesus. So the Holy Spirit is like Jesus with us. All the attributes, all the power of Jesus in us. So never look at the Holy Spirit as, okay, only when I need to speak in tongues, he will come. Or only when I need healing, he will come. No. Everything what Jesus is, the Holy Spirit is. Everything what the Holy Spirit is, the Father is. Everything that the Father is, the Jesus and the Holy Spirit is. It's one. They have different roles. And when the Holy Spirit comes to us, he will come to aid us. He will come to strengthen us. Romans 8:26 states that he helps us in our weaknesses. He takes a hold together with us against our weakness, right? But we must be willing to go to him, ask him to help in our times of weaknesses. Holy Spirit is there. So we must be willing to ask the Holy Spirit for help. Right? He comes alongside us. He aids us. He assists us. Without the Holy Spirit, we cannot go through the situations in life that is there. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise a standard against him. Without the Holy Spirit, we will fail. Without the Holy Spirit, our ministry will fail. Without the Holy Spirit, our personal life will fail. We cannot do anything without the Holy Spirit. Get that into ourselves. God has given us skills. God has given us abilities, talents. That's good. But without the Holy Spirit, we will fail. It's the end of the story. We cannot do anything. We can do some things, but it's not going to last. It's not going to be fruitful. We need the Holy Spirit. He helps us in our weakness. He does this through prayer and intercession. He enters us. He empowers us. And sometimes we don't feel like praying. Many times it's happened to us. You know, we have the supernatural hour. Many times. I'm so tired. I don't want to sing. You know, I just want to rest. I just want to, you know, go back home, relax and rest. Why should I take so much time, you know, struggle singing those high scales and then singing and then, you know, sometimes you don't get a response from anyone and sometimes all these things upset. But when we take Jesus, when we say take him by his word, he empowers us through prayer. He empowers us. He strengthens us. He enables us to do it. So it's not our own strength, but it's the power of the Holy Spirit working in us. Get it? So sometimes we may feel weak. I don't want to pray. Yes, nothing wrong. It's a natural. We are tired. We are weak. There's fear. There's anxiety. There's doubt. Go ask the Holy Spirit. It's okay to cry. It's okay to go and weep before God. Nothing wrong. But you ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, this is my weakness. You strengthen me. Enable me to pray. Enable me to look to you. Stir in me. Give me a word from the scriptures. Your word is alive, oh God. Give me a word that I can hold on to this word and be encouraged in the season that I'm in. That's what the Holy Spirit will do. Right? And so we need him. Without him, we cannot do anything. Learn to relate to Jesus as our Holy Spirit. As our high priest. As you enter the presence of God, learn to relate as Jesus as a high priest. So you can go to your room, you lock the door, and you're praying, Lord Jesus, I thank you. I thank you for what you have done. That moment in the spirit, learn to relate who you're praying to. Jesus is in heaven. He's standing. And just picture you know, the Father sitting there. The Holy Spirit is in you. The Holy Spirit is saying, you pray like this. You pray. Jesus is listening. Do you have that picture in your mind? Right? Think of it that way. The Father sitting there. Jesus is, you know, just probably standing at the right hand of the Father. And he's looking at you. And you're weak, you're tired, you're weary. And there you got the Spirit of Jesus. The Holy Spirit is saying, you pray this. He will understand. He will understand. You pray. I'll help you to pray. That's what he does. He learned to relate the one who completely acquitted you in the presence of God. So when you go into his presence, learn to be bold. Learn to be confident. Don't be afraid. He knows our weaknesses. Right? He knows our challenges. We don't have to tell Lord, these are my weaknesses. He knows it. Still, we can tell it. He's compassionate. We tell him all our weaknesses. God, I'm fearful. I have pain. I don't know what, you know, some of the things for me personally is, you know, when I look at my two kids, they're so innocent. 8 years and 6 years. So innocent. But they're growing in a world that soon that innocence will go away. And as a father, sometimes I think, God, I pray and I say, God, protect them from the evil one. There's so much that's happening around. Right? They'll go to school, they'll grow up, they go to 10th standard, they'll finish their exam, they go to college, then there's no more, they'll not say, where's dad or where's mama? No, they're on their own. Only now it is, you know, where's dad or where's mama? All that will change. So there's this feeling, God, only you can protect them. Only you can, you know, be with them. That's sometimes a fear, but at that moment you take that fear, take it captive. What I say is, no, God is with them. Even if I'm not there, even if I'm not there as a father, I know God is there with them. God's presence is there. God will protect them. God will be with them. There's only so much I can do as a father, but you are their heavenly father. You will control their life. You will take them next, right? And that's what it is. We all go through fears, you know. Just because I'm a, you know, pastor preaching, teaching, doesn't mean we don't have all. We are also natural. We go through these things, and that's when we go to the Father. We ask the Holy Spirit, give us the strength, right? Know that He is interceding with you. He, as you take your request to the Father in His name, what is it? You're saying, Father, please, you know, heal this person. Right? Jesus is standing there and interceding on your behalf. Isaiah 53. What does Isaiah 53 says? It says, surely He has borne our griefs. He has carried our sickness and our sorrows. Yet we have stricken Him, afflicted by God. But by His stripes we are healed. Are you saying that? What is happening? He is interceding on our behalf. Saying, yes. I picture Jesus saying, Lord, Father, see this. See the stripes. You see the wounds on my body? By His stripes, by this stripes, I'm healed. This boy should be healed because of the stripes. Right? And just 2 points and we'll take a break. Know that He is there. He's merciful. He is faithful. He will strengthen you in our weakness. And know that He speaks the Father's heart to you by the Spirit. How can I hear the Father? How can I hear what the Word of God is, what God is telling me? One, look at God's Word. Two, He will reveal His purpose through the Holy Spirit. And say, this is what I'm going to do. Right? Okay, we'll take a break and we'll come back and continue.